entrenched in my own religion as a Jew, I could so easily be converted. I have to say that I find your uninhibited fervour and enthusiasm totally inspirational. I always have done. And a special word for the three very young ones who were back in the percussion. I share Jane's view of how wonderful it is to have young people in the room. So often these days, you don't get young people being as involved, being as inspirational, being as religiously inspired, and it inspires others. It certainly inspires me. And I'm privileged to be here, and Mike, I can assure you that the inspiration is entirely mutual, because you are a most amazing, special person. Yeah. And this congregation is privileged to have you as their leader. And your whole family. Basically, what I want to do this afternoon is to share some random thoughts about Israel, and some random thoughts about this world that we're living in, this crazy, difficult world we're living in. And Jane, you were so right when you mentioned that these are difficult times. In all of the history of Israel, I can't honestly think of more difficult times of what is going on in the world, what we are facing generally, the amount of horror that the world is experiencing now. And one can only hope that God on high is listening to your prayers. And at some stage, there will be a turnaround from this, because as things are at the moment, the future doesn't look that bright. I'm sorry, I'm not coming here to give you a bad message, and I promise you I will leave you on a high. But we have to be realistic. We have to know what we're up against. We have to try to understand why in this ugly world, where, for example, in Syria, something like 220,000 people have been killed, where what's going on all around the world, the horror recently with more terrorist attacks in places that haven't experienced them before. We have to try to understand why, amongst all of that, that little Israel, as you call her, the apple of God's eye, why is little Israel the focus of the world's attention, the focus of the UN's hatred, the focus of the EU's hatred beginning, and a lack of understanding throughout the world? Why? What is it about Israel? And unfortunately, with the growth of anti-Semitism as well, and you look and ask the question why, it's very difficult not to come back to the fact that Israel is suffering and under the spotlight because she is the one and only Jewish state. And I think we have to accept that. I'm not one for bandying anti-Semitism around, but it's hitting us all in the face now. And we really can't ignore it, and we can't pretend. So when to have congregations like yours who are standing up for Israel, communities around the world standing up for Israel, particularly many Christian communities, but again, not understanding why intelligent people and some of the churches and some of the church leaders cannot see the truth. I fail to understand how intelligent academics, intelligent people, can actually buy into the lies without knowing what they're doing. And the worst of all, unfortunately, and the thing that we have to try to counter, and it's most difficult to counter, are the Jews and the Israelis who buy into that hatred. This is something that is hard to understand, makes it very difficult for those of us who are pro-Israel to fight, because somebody will turn around and say, well, Ilan Pape says this, so it must be true, or other anti-Israel Israelis talk, and we've got a conference coming up in Exeter. We had to fight a conference in Southampton where it was going to be anti-Israel. How can they not see the truth? How can they not see what Israel does for the world? And I'll go into some of that a little bit later on. As far as the current situation, I'm at a loss to understand America. I am at a loss to understand Obama. I think the vast majority of people who voted for him with such hope are at a loss to understand him. I am at a loss to understand how a country can do what it's doing with Iran, when Iran will be on the streets calling death to America, death to Israel, death to the Jews, laughing at us, laughing at America, basically, for being so naive, for believing that Iran means a single word of what it says. The only word that Iran believes and means is the destruction of Israel. That is the only part of it. And we are going, if the world doesn't wake up very soon, we are going to be in a terrible world situation. Never mind the Palestinian-Israeli situation, never mind the anti-Semitism. It's time for the world to wake up to the danger that it is facing, because it is, unfortunately. So from that point of view, I cannot understand. I can only pray that before it's too late, that something can be done, at least to put in some controls, at least to put in some restrictions. There's nothing in the relationship between America and what it's given. It's given everything back to Iran. And the money that is being given to Iran, billions of dollars, are already being used to fund terrorism, are already being used to fund certainly in the north of Israel, Hezbollah and Hamas, being used to fund them to actually attack Israel and go for this destruction of Israel. So from that point of view, I think the Americans have woken up to it, but they've woken up too late. But somewhere along the line, somebody has to see the light. They have to say that enough is enough, and you can't have a completely free hand to do what you want. And that is what Iran has at the moment. So from that point of view, I am actually seriously worried. I want to talk a little bit about the relationship with the UK and Israel. In the main, it's not a bad relationship. There's no doubt that our Prime Minister has been supportive. But words aren't enough. We need deeds. We need those words to be turned into action. We need those words to become reality, standing up for Israel when it matters, not going to the UN and voting against Israel in the UN, or something like the World Health Organization, who has named Israel as the worst violator of health in the world. And that is the sort of thing we're up against. And so from that point of view, things are not great. They really are not great. We've got organisations like UNRWA, the ones who are supposed to help the refugees. The actual director of UNRWA has very, very strong links with Islamists who are against Israel, and that is a problem. We have a situation where we have Palestinian refugees in the most awful situation. I feel, and I'm sure everyone in this room feels, for the genuine Palestinian refugees. I wouldn't want to live as a refugee in Gaza. I wouldn't want to live as a refugee in Lebanon or in Syria or anywhere else. But the only ones that they seem to care about, the world seems to care about and criticise, is anything to do with Israel. You can't get them to criticise anything else. And there shouldn't be a refugee problem in 2015, when in 1948 they had the opportunity of their state, and throughout the years there have been opportunities for peace, and Hamas and the Palestinian Authority and Yasser Arafat have stood in the way of any improvement for refugees. To the extent when Israel had the opportunity to build houses in Gaza and had started building new houses, the United Nations ordered them to tear them down and put back the bad conditions so that their, quote, their refugee status would not be jeopardized. So these people have been held as refugees all these years. They have, in Jenin, the British government sent a team of builders to Jenin. Everybody thinks that Jenin was totally wiped out. It wasn't. It was a particular area which was, quote, the refugee camp. And the United Kingdom sent a team of builders. They were building in Jenin. They were sent home. They were sent home because, again, refugee status was at and then being used as political pawns was at stake. So this is the kind of thing we're up against. But I do genuinely feel for the Palestinians. But this nonsense, this utter, utter nonsense of the siege of Gaza. What rubbish. What utter, utter rubbish. I could give you lists, or I could tell you to go to websites where you will see the daily trucks rolling into Gaza from Israel. What other country in the world supplies its enemies whilst in a state of war? What other country would do that? And then you get stories of how the electricity has been cut off by Israel. Again, rubbish. The electricity is cut off when it suits Hamas, when it wants to damn Israel and make Israel look bad. And, by the way, they don't pay for the electricity that goes in, so they owe Israel millions and millions of dollars. And also, if you want to find an area of Gaza where it's luxurious, where people live in great wealth, and they have their country clubs and their great restaurants and hotels and things, when I read that, I didn't believe it. I actually didn't believe it. So what did I do? I looked up the telephone number of the country club and the luxury restaurant. I phoned the restaurant, not believing that I would find it, and I made a booking for 8 people. I didn't turn up, but I made a booking for 8 people in Gaza. And really, there is luxury there, and the way, the difference between the poverty of the refugees, who, as I say, believe me, you should all pray for, because it's a horrible life and nobody would want it. But it's their leaders' fault. It is not Israel's fault. Nothing that happens to the Palestinians has been Israel's fault. And there are good sides as well. There are many combined operations, cooperation going on between Israelis and Palestinians. They work alongside each other in the hospitals. They work alongside each other in the universities. IFA University has a huge number of Arab students, so does the Hebrew University. They all walk along. And I want to share one thing in particular with you, if I can find the right piece of paper, because I don't usually work with pieces of paper. I actually want to read something to you. I very seldom read anything when I speak, but I want to read something to you. This is an Egyptian-born student who gave the valedictorian speech at the Hebrew University. And I'll repeat that because it's pretty amazing. Yeah. An Egyptian-born student giving the valedictorian remarks at that. And I just want to read it and share it with you because I think it's worth it. Loud cheers greeted Hassan, I should read the last time, shouldn't I? Hassan Hassarez, as he took his spot behind the podium during a graduation ceremony. I beg your pardon, it wasn't the Hebrew University, it's Tel Aviv University, last week. The young man did, after all, win the coveted honour of valedictorian for the prestigious international master's programme, and the audience sat eager for a message of wisdom and reflection on the year that was. Yet as Hassan shared the story of his journey to Israel, a startled hush fell across the room as the audience listened in rapt attention. Everybody in this room has a friend or a family member who wanted him not to come to Israel, the bright young graduate said. There's war there. Aren't you afraid of being blown up? Do they even have water there? Do Jews speak English? If you think we heard a million reasons why not to come to Israel, he confided, I heard 1.5 million. Growing up in Egypt, my entire country had opinions about Israel, and none of them were positive. Born and raised in rural Egypt, Hassarim shared with the enthralled audience how his childhood was filled with anti-Israel propaganda, both at home and in the media. My exposure to Israel was through music and television, he explained. On the radio, there were anthems about the destruction Israel had caused. In the movies, Israel was spies and thieves. And in spite of the fact that our country struck a famous peace accord in 1979, the Israelis, I was told, were our worst enemies. And I will just reflect on that in a moment. Yes, there is still a peace between Egypt and Israel. It's a very, very thin peace, and there's a lot that is not to be desired there. The years of enforced stereotyping certainly left its mark. In fact, Hassarein enrolled in Tel Aviv University's international master's program and came to Israel expecting the worst. At the airport, when the security official asked why I decided to come here, I half joked. I always heard the Jews are bad people, and I came to see this for myself. Not unlike, many of you may know of, not unlike the young man, the young Muslim man, Kasim Hafiz, who went from the UK to Israel to see the worst because he wanted to see apartheid in Israel, and as a result of his visit to Israel became the most dedicated pro-Israel Zionist that you could ever find. Yet Hazarim's belief about Israel, the Jews, and life in the Jewish state was about to change forever. I expected to find that people were unfriendly and especially unhappy to meet Egyptians, he explained. I was pleasantly surprised to find just the opposite. I was invited everywhere, from Shabbat dinner to Ramadan iftar meals, to plays and even to political gatherings. And the diversity I found here was as surprising as the warmth of the people, he continued. On my very first day here in the university, I saw men in kippot and women in headscarves and hijabs. I learned there were people of every kind on campus, and the university had a space for all of them. Jews, Muslims, Christians, Druze, Bedouin, and even international students. His respect for Israel and its society grew as he explored the country. How fascinating it is to be in a country where you can go to the beach and see a Muslim woman and a Hasid sharing the same small space. Where can you find a Christian Arab whose apartment is decorated in posters of Mao and Lenin? Where else can you see a Bedouin IDF soldier reading the Quran on the train during Ramadan? Where else can you see Ashkenazi and Mizrahi Jews arguing about whether or not Ashkenazi females had kidnapped Yemenite babies in the 1950s? To be sure, my experience has been defined by the unexpected. Pondering the beliefs he held before exploring Israel and finding out for himself, Hassanin admitted, I often reflect on the strangeness of coming to the country where the people I was taught to think of as enemies were transformed into my teachers, classmates, vendors, doctors, and guidance counselors. When Israelis ask me, how does it feel for you to be in the country? I have to be honest, and I tell them, before I knew you, I didn't like you. But I never considered that my enemies would accept me to their school, to their country, and moreover, to their society. I hope you feel that that was nice. I have another great fear these days, and that is, when is the world going to wake up how Christians are being treated in the Middle East? When are we all going to wake up? When are we going to do something about it? When are we not going to be like what it's like in the Holocaust, where everybody knew but turned a blind eye? It's time the world woke up to what is happening to Christians. And as far as the current situation with ISIS, ISIL, or whatever you want to call them, very recently they have taken over another village in Syria, which has a large number of Christians. Ladies and gentlemen, pray for them. Pray as you've never prayed before for them. Because what is happening is nothing short of incredible, incredible horror. A man, somebody who can stand over another person and behead them, let a child do the same. There are pictures of children being taught this. What the children are being taught on Palestinian television, the usual story of Jews being apes and pigs, and that their aim is to become, we call them actually, they're not even homicide bombers, they're human bombs. Yes. They are human bombs. And to teach them, that the glory is waiting for them in heaven if they do that. And mothers who actually wish their children the luck and watch them make their videos. And one mother who's had one son who became a homicide bomber and prayed that the other son would become a homicide bomber. It isn't in our psyche to know that kind of thing, to behave like that, to think like that. And this is really one of the big tragedies of our time. So as I say, what is going on with Christians, the diminishing communities everywhere, the gall of people who said that the the Christian community is diminishing in Israel, where in fact it is the only area where they're properly protected and it's growing. But these are the lies that people will listen to and buy into. So from that point of view, things are not of the best. Chris Guinness, who's the UNRWA director, has the audacity to write a piece that says that Israel is responsible for the growing mortality, Palestinian growing mortality rate. Israel has done more for the Palestinians and for the Arab, their Arab population than anywhere else in the Middle East. Yeah. Israeli Arabs wouldn't change their role for anything. Whenever there's a problem, there are queues at the consul's office for Israeli Arabs to take up their citizenship because they want to remain. It is true that there are sometimes difficulties. I just read this morning that Bibi Netanyahu actually cancelled a visit to the north where there's a large population because a group there had said that they didn't want the baby murderer to come to their area. That's the sort of thing we're hearing. But on the whole, the Arabs, they are. It is true that not everything is perfect, but not everything's perfect anywhere in the world. And they have a better life, I would venture to say, they have a better life in Israel than Arabs have pretty well anywhere else. What else have I got to tell you? Boycotts. Ridiculous, ridiculous boycotts. First of all, if boycotters were consistent, they would not be using a mobile phone, they wouldn't be using a computer. I've got a whole list of things. I'll go into a few more. But things like Norway, who stopped an Israeli film about handicapped children being shown because the film was not negative about Israel. About Sweden, who stopped a rap singer, Mattis Yahu, from going. He's an American Jew. He's not an Israeli. What are they stopping an American Jew from going to Sweden under the boycott? We have letters in our Guardian or sometimes other newspapers, sometimes the Times. Many, many theatrical personalities over here, cultural personalities, speaking out against Israel. Again, unfortunately, very heavily peppered by Jewish names. Something, again, we are really, really struggling with. So from that point of view, it's quite ridiculous what we're up against. But let's talk about the good things. Let's talk about, really, there's one gentleman, and I don't know how he does it, but every single week or fortnight, he manages to come up. This week is 8 pages of good news from Israel. It's well worth you going onto his website. I have to exactly get it for me. It's michael.goodnewsisrael. No, that's his email address. It just put in good news from Israel. It's Michael Ordman. And do yourself a favour and give yourself a boost. Give yourself a feel-good boost because it is amazing. What Israel does for the world, no other tiny country, nearly 67 years old, has achieved in hundreds and hundreds of years. Nothing compares with what Israel is prepared to share. And Israel is prepared to share with everybody. It shares with all the nations who take what Israel has to give, who go out there, who improve their agriculture, who treat their children, who go out doing operations, save a child's heart, who bring children into Israel. Israeli hospitals have many Palestinian children. Many Saudi Arabians come into Israel for treatment. And in fact, Mahmoud Abbas, I think it was his daughter, who was treated in Israel. You know, they'll take what Israel can give. But they'll go to the United Nations, which has an inbuilt anti-Israel majority. So you could say to the United Nations, the sky's black today. And they would vote, the sky is black today, because that is the inbuilt Arab-Africa majority. Now, despite the fact that in many of those African countries, Israelis have been out there, have taught them, have helped them, have done so much for them. And all the medical and wonderful innovations, the technical innovations, Israel is seen really, as far as technology is concerned, as second only to the US. And many of the top US companies have their places in Israel. So what is this? Why are we so demonized? And there is this organizations, the Palestine Solidarity Campaign. There are Jewish people coming in. I forget his name. Max Blumenthal was in the UK. He is Jewish. He is out there with the Palestine Solidarity, speaking to audiences, sadly, very often in Quaker meeting houses. The Quakers were so good to the Jews. And after the Holocaust, nobody was better to the Jews than the Quakers. More Quakers took in Jewish children on the kinder transport than, you know, we didn't have enough Jewish people taking in the children. And now they are mainly the headquarters of Palestine Solidarity, which is a tragedy, and you can't reason with them. So, again, from that point of view, Israel is demonized yet again. But let me share just a little bit of the good news. But before I do that, just one thing I did want to talk about, and that is another reason why I'm absolutely at a loss to understand America. And that is a list of things that America is benefiting from Israel. And I was amazed. I actually only took this off the computer last night, which is why I haven't got it firmly up here yet. Right. JFK light rail is protected by Israeli surveillance. It's an Israeli system enabled images to be transmitted from Mars, an Israeli system that was. The Israeli Air Force pilot technology is training basketball and hockey players, US hockey players. I'm not quite sure how that works, but still. US Marines are using Israeli handheld computers to communicate in Afghanistan and Iraq. And this goes on. The US state-of-the-art F-35 strike fighter aircraft has an Israeli-mounted display system in their helmets to provide them with flight data. What is America doing to Israel at the moment? Why have they suddenly turned against? Why don't they realize just how much benefit they are getting and just how important it is for them to have Israel as an ally there? And it's become more and more difficult. And there's no point in blaming Bibi Netanyahu and saying that he shouldn't have gone to speak to Congress. Once he'd said he was going to go to Congress, of course he should go to Congress. It would have been outrageous to back down and not go. Yes. Completely outrageous. And so those in the Jewish community who tried to advise him differently ought to be ashamed of themselves. Right, let's just do a little bit of good news then. Right. How many people in this room have back pain? Right, so there is a new Israeli system. Novomatrix has reported success from independent controlled trials of its hyperstimulation pulse device for treating lower back pain. And a study of 28 patients in Belgium, interestingly, obtained significant pain relief after 4 treatments compared to a control group. So, ladies and gentlemen, hopefully, back pain. Why isn't the world listening to Israel, who is already making huge progress in research into multiple sclerosis, some tremendous breakthroughs this year in the field of cancer, breakthroughs in Alzheimer's, breakthroughs in the common cold? All along the way, there are things in Israel that are benefiting the world, are being shared with the world at no cost and expecting no favours in return and getting no favours in return. There are some pharmacists here in the UK who are arguing that the Israeli pharmaceutical company Teva should be boycotted. They should know that 1 in every 4 pill or medication used in this country comes from Teva. They also should know that Teva have 4 factories in the UK, giving work to UK citizens and providing their medication for around the world. Israel has so much to give. And from that, and Mike, can you be clear on time, please? Just
whenever you want.
That's not the answer I want. Okay, no worries. There's protection against flu. There's all kinds, just literally everything. Acne, you name it, Israel is looking into it. Technologically, I think it's Bill Gates who said that Israel is absolutely leading the world. I'm not quite sure whether I fancy Bill Gates as the president of America. I don't know. But there doesn't seem to be a lot of good choice out there, and I certainly don't fancy Hillary Clinton, I can tell you. She's unfortunately, there is so much two-faced activity going on in the world. You know, somebody will go, people are very naive. They will go, Ed Miliband was good at this, they will go to speak at a Palestinian meeting. And they will tell the Palestinians what they want to hear. He will then go to the Jewish Board of Deputies and tell the Jewish Board of Deputies what they want to hear. Are they stupid enough to think that we don't hear both of those and say you're a liar? Because that is really what we're down to. And there is so much two-faced behaviour around. Hillary Clinton will tell you she's a friend of Israel. Obama used to. He can't even pretend anymore. And God knows what will happen if Jeremy Corbyn is fired. And you know what? I think to some extent we've been guilty. We've been guilty of almost pumping up the publicity and almost encouraging people who are against Israel or against the Jews to think that he may be a good option. And I don't know what's going to happen. I don't think anybody in this room knows what's going to happen. But the thought, all right, thank God at the moment he's in opposition. And there are people who say that he will bring damage to the party. But what he also will bring to the party with his views and probably embracing George Galloway and what have you, he will bring in a large Muslim vote into the party. Yeah. And that is to be feared. So from I really don't know what's going to happen. The only thing I can say is that in this country, fortunately, there isn't a huge amount of power in opposition in terms of legislation, but he can do an awful lot of damage if he comes in. And I don't think people have a clue. And I find it absolutely incredible that the Labour Party can have a voting system where for the princely sum of £3, I could sign up and vote for the Labour Party leader. And thousands of people, my last count was well over 18,000 people. And the people who are doing that, although I think you did say, can't even remember your name now, but you did say earlier that you thought that some of the people who are signing up are conservatives as well, who think that having Jeremy Corbyn as the head of the Labour Party will damage them. Awesome. That's a bit stupid in my view. Yes. Anybody else could pay £3. I think the deadline has probably passed, but we could have paid that. And so trade unionists and people across the board who, and all the left-wingers are signing up, and we could finish up with Jeremy Corbyn. We really could finish up with Jeremy Corbyn, and then it's a case of watch this space. There's a new system after surgery. Sometimes it's very difficult to heal wounds or seal it up. Israel have created something for that. I'm sure many of you have heard of the the camera in the pill. I sometimes say the pill in the camera. It's the camera in the pill, where you swallow a pill and it sends pictures back. And all kinds of things that are helping, many, many things that will almost make the conventional operating room quite obsolete. So here again, Israel is out there helping the world. I spoke about Save a Child's Heart, that is people going out or bringing children in. There's a whole organization that goes out doing heart operations. We are always, and I say we because I proudly say we when I talk about Israel, we are always at the forefront of any international disaster. You name it, Israel is there. And it's not there waiting at the airport to be told what to do. It's there with its field hospital at the ready. How many babies around the world are now called Israel because they were born in Israeli field hospitals? And it's out there. It takes the sniffer dogs to earthquake areas. Actually, in Manchester and around the country next week, we've got an IDF officer who was part of the Nepal mission and is coming to speak in the UK. And she was part of the team. Admittedly, one of their big priorities, and rightly so, was to find the missing Israelis. But while they were finding missing Israelis and were criticised for that, they were also saving lives. Wonderful picture of bringing somebody out quite a few days after the disaster and the euphoria of that team in finding somebody alive. We're always, always, always there, always ready to help the world. And so, what can I say? We need a lot of support. Israel needs a lot of support because they are difficult times. And I actually want to end, and I'm perfectly happy then to take, I'm not a person who says it has to be questions, I'm happy to take comments as well. But if I can find the right bit of paper, and that is going to be a challenge, because I have a task for you. I'm going to put that down for a second, sorry about this. Not usually as disorganized as this. And if I can't find it, I'll do it from the top of my head. But I have a list for you, I hope. Indeed, have a list.
Yes.
I have a prayer list for you. Here we are in a gathering, a really sincere, fervent group of believing people who believe in prayer. And actually, when you talk about Israel, you don't only have to believe in prayer, you have to believe in miracles. Because Israel's history is peppered with miracles. From the very beginning in 1948, when the State of Israel was declared, five Arab armies, fully equipped, fully, armed Arab armies, came and invaded every border of Israel, a country that didn't have a build-up of weapons, didn't have arms, and Israel prevailed. If that isn't a miracle, I don't know what is. At the time of the Yom Kippur War, when Israeli soldiers were surprised in their synagogues, I remember going home during the day, and although I shouldn't have done because we're not allowed to, I switched the television on Yom Kippur, and seeing that Israel had been invaded. It went round like wildfire. It went round the world like wildfire, and the Israeli troops were there within, thank God, enough time to hold back that. That was another miracle. We could have been overrun so easily. The Six-Day War, doing that at that time. Going to Jerusalem and retaking the wall. But now the world is telling us that it doesn't belong to Israel, that Jews do not have the right to pray on the Temple Mount anymore. There's a woman who is an American who's recently made Aliyah and gone to live in Israel, was attacked by one of the hijab-wearing women and punched at the Temple Mount and not helped by the police. I mean, this is something no Jew should be prevented from going, and no government should allow this to happen. And it's time that the Temple Mount was open to all, and that's something that we absolutely have. List. And if you don't want to write it and you want to leave me an email address afterwards or put it on the table over there, I'll send it out, because it's quite a long prayer list. You're going to have to pray pretty hard, and I know you're good at it. I've watched you, and it's inspirational watching you. My prayer list is Obama from being prevented from doing too much more damage before the end of his term. That's one of my prayers. People to see the light about the danger posed to the world by Iran before it is too late. The world to wake up to what is happening to Christians in the Middle East and to pray for the Christians. I pray that the positives will outweigh the negatives when it's regarding boycotts, and I also pray for a realization about the benefits that peace can bring, not just to Israel, but to Israel and the Palestinians. There is so much benefit. There was an email today that said it's worth £110 million to the Israelis for peace and £50 million to the Palestinians for peace. I don't quite know how they come up with the figures, but clearly peace is of such great benefit. And where Israelis and Palestinians and Arabs within Israel are living side by side, you can see the benefits. The West Bank is one of the fastest growing economies in the world. Okay, it starts from a low base, but it is growing, and there's a lot of investment by UK Jewry and others in the north of Israel, where there are large Arab communities, to improve the life of the Arabs. So there's a lot going for it there. I pray, and I've touched on this here, that intelligent people buying into the lies about Israel will finally see the light and will realize where the truth lies and who is to blame for the situation. I pray, and this is a very special prayer, that organizations like Father's House, Christians for Zion, Baptists for Israel, and the embryonic Welsh Friends of Israel, that they prosper and grow and bring benefit to Israel. And I wish you all the greatest success. And I pray that Israelis and Jews who are anti-Israel are exposed as what they are, which is traitors. They are traitors, and I want them exposed. And finally, what do we all pray for? There is only one thing. It's the most common word in the Israeli Hebrew language. And we pray for shalom. We pray for peace. And with the will of God, your prayers and my prayers will be answered. Amen.
Thank you for your honesty.